Hello students, today we will discuss epidemiology of non-communicable diseases. Our learning outcomes, number one, to define and characterize the different non-communicable diseases, to discuss the differences between non-communicable and communicable diseases, and lastly, to outline the approaches of epidemiologists to prevent the global burden of NCDs. NCDs are chronic conditions that do not result from an acute process, and they also do not have an infectious causative agent, hence are termed as not communicable. These are also diseases that have long or prolonged course that does not resolve spontaneously, and for which a complete cure is rarely achieved. Using that definition, we can now characterize NCDs. NCDs have complex etiology. Ibig sabihin, maraming iba't ibang cause of disease. But, however, there is an exception. The main causative agent shall not be an infectious or non-contagious origin. Okay. There is also an interplay of multiple risk factors, no? Mamaya i-discuss natin lahat 'yan. And this interplay of risk factors will cause a long latency period. Anong ibig sabihin nito? Matagal pa natin malalaman o madadiagnose yung pasyente before nila ma-realize na na-develop nila yung disorder. Okay? And then after the disorder the diagnosis, it will cause a prolonged course of illness before developing a permanent disability or complication. There are a lot of different types of NCDs. So first, we will discuss the cardiovascular disease, cancer, chronic respiratory disease, diabetes, chronic neurologic disorders, example of which are Alzheimer's disease and different types of dementias. Next, arthritis and other musculoskeletal diseases. And lastly, the unintentional injuries brought about by, number one, your motor vehicular crashes or MVCs. Now, let's take a look on the trends of causes of mortality among Filipinos. Number one, the most common cause of death in the Philippines is ischemic heart disease, or in layman's term, heart attack. Okay? Next naman, neoplasms, or also known as cancer, followed by cerebrovascular disease. Most common name yan is stroke. Okay? So, sa brain yan. Next naman, diabetes mellitus. And then, top 5 natin is pneumonia. So, ang pneumonia, kung mapapansin natin sa top 5 causes of disease or of death, pneumonia lang ang communicable type of disease. Itong apat na to, non-communicable yung mga yan. Let's proceed with top 6 hypertensive diseases, which is a non-communicable disorder. Next, tuberculosis, COVID-19 virus, chronic lower respiratory infections are all communicable disorders. Plus, no, the diseases of genitourinary system. Ano yung mga yan? Yung mga UTIs natin. Okay? These are all communicable. Now, remember that non-communicable diseases are caused by an interplay of risk factors. So, what is a risk factor? It is defined as an aspect of personal behavior or a lifestyle, an environmental exposure, or an hereditary characteristic or interplay of your genetics. Okay? That can cause an increased occurrence of a disease or other health conditions. risk factors can be modifiable or non-modifiable. So, what is a modifiable risk factor? It is defined as a behavior or a lifestyle risk factor that can be reduced or controlled by intervention, thereby reducing the probability of development of the disease. The following are examples of modifiable risk factors. So first, the physical inactivity, tobacco use or cigarette smoking, alcohol use, and unhealthy diets, which includes increased fat and sodium intake, low fruit and vegetable intake. So again, no, ito yung mga risk factors na kaya mong baguhin, kaya tinawag na modifiable. So pwede mo silang kontrolin, okay? Halimbawa, yung cigarette use, alcohol use, and unhealthy diets, kaya mo yan kontrolin, okay? Physical inactivity, no? Pwede mo yan ipalitan ng exercise, no? Mapa-isotonic or isometric exercise pa yan. In contrast, non-modifiable risk factors are factors that cannot be reduced or controlled. So, ito yung mga hindi na natin kayang baguhin pa. Number one, your age, gender, no, race, and genetics or family history. So let's now have a small activity. Let's identify the effect of the following risk factors to your non-communicable disease. So, identify natin, kaya bang mag-develop ng cardiovascular disease from prolonged cigarette smoking? Okay, yes, possible. How about diabetes? Pwede rin. Okay. Cancer, especially lung cancer, pwedeng-pwede. And respiratory or chronic respiratory disease, syempre lungs yan, so pwede yan. How about unhealthy diet? Kaya ba yan na mag-develop ng heart diseases? Most especially kapag madami kang kinakaing fats. Okay? Pwede yan. Diabetes? Sure. Lalo na kapag high carbohydrate diet ang ginagawa mo araw-araw. Okay? Cancer? Pwedeng-pwede. Okay? Lalo na kung mahilig ka sa mga may mga preservatives. Chronic respiratory disease? Malabo. Okay? Next naman tayo sa physical inactivity. Kaya bang mag-produce or mag-develop ng heart disease? Pwede, lalo na kapag nagiging obese ka na. Okay? Diabetes. Sure, no? Hindi mo na-burn lahat ng mga kinakain mo. Plus, tumataas yung glucose content ng blood. How about cancer? Possible, kasi obesity is now number one risk factor for a lot of cancer, lalo-lalo na sa mga babae. Okay? Okay, next is alcohol use. So, unfortunately, no, prolonged alcohol use can also develop heart diseases. Okay? And can also damage your pancreas. Thus, your insulin production is low, kaya pwede mag-develop ng diabetes. Cancer, pwedeng-pwede yan, okay? Lalo na liver cancer. Chronic respiratory diseases, malabo pa din. Next, we will discuss metabolic risk factor. These risk factors refer to the biochemical processes that involves body's normal functioning. So, the behaviors or lifestyle which are modifiable at the same time metabolic are as follows. Okay? Raised blood pressure, raised total cholesterol, elevated glucose, and overweight and obesity. So, these are, again, no, modifiable, kaya mong i-control or i-reduce, at the same time, they're also classified as metabolic. So now let me discuss the four leading NCDs globally. So first, your cardiovascular diseases, diabetes mellitus, chronic respiratory disease, and cancer. Marami tayong diseases that can be classified under this group. Okay? Number one, your coronary heart disease. Coronary heart disease ang pangalan niya kasi the main problem in this disease is the coronary vessels or yung mga blood vessels supplying oxygen to your heart. Okay? Next naman, cerebrovascular disease. Cerebro means cerebrum. Nasa brain yan, no? So, yung mga problem naman natin dito are the blood vessels supplying oxygen to your brain. Next naman is peripheral arterial disease or PAD. These disorders are affects your blood, the blood vessels supplying the peripheral extremities. Ibig sabihin yung arms and legs. And lastly, your congenital heart disease. These are the malformations or deformities na makikita natin at birth. Let me discuss the interplay of the mentioned modifiable risk factors. No, halimbawa, no, you're inactive physically, no, madami kang kinakaing mga pagkain na rich in carbohydrates and fats, no? They will cause an interplay of inflammatory processes lalong-lalo na sa mga blood vessels mo. Halimbawa, no, increase glucose intake will cause a defect in your liver, no? Ibig sabihin kasi ang site of cholesterol metabolism ay sa liver. Okay? So therefore, no, may ipon ngayon lahat ng cholesterol mo sa katawan, lalong-lalo na in between the layers of your blood vessels. So therefore, itong effect na to will cause a decrease in elasticity of your blood vessels. And then therefore, no, magsisikip yan. And then eventually, wala nang madideliver na oxygen towards the target organ. So a while ago, sinabi ko, no, yung cardiovascular disease sa puso yan, cerebrovascular disease sa brain naman. What is the global burden of CVDs? CVDs are number one cause of mortality globally. And number one among the types of CVDs is the coronary heart disease, causing heart attack. And then next naman, yung cerebrovascular disease mo, na, also known as stroke. Most of these deaths occur in low to middle income countries because of the economic effects towards the heart, the health reforms, di ba? Number one, hindi naman laging libre yung mga medicines and diagnostics sa mga ganitong countries. By 2030, almost 25 million will die from CVDs. Next thing di-discuss natin ay diabetes mellitus. These are group of disorders that affects the control of blood sugar. Okay? So we have different types of diabetes. Number one, type 1 DM, type 2 DM. Next is gestational DM. Next, no, itong last two natin is the recently added types of diabetes mellitus. Number 4 is MODY. Number 5, the type 3 diabetes mellitus. In type 1 diabetes mellitus, the pancreas cannot produce and release insulin. And as we all know, insulin is the main hormone for decreasing the blood glucose or sugar. Next is type 2 diabetes. In this type, there is a sufficient amount of insulin, but your body do not respond well to that. This phenomenon is called insulin resistance. So there are a lot of differences between the two types of diabetes. So in type 1, genetics and autoimmune problem play a causative role, while in type 2, it is caused by little bit of genetics and but more on lifestyle and aging. We also see type 1 diabetes mellitus mostly in young patients, while type 2 diabetes can be seen mostly in adults. For the treatment, type 1 can require insulin in treatment regimen, but however in type 2, you may add only insulin on top of the tablets or other oral medications. For the prevention, no known prevention strategies can be done for type 1 diabetes mellitus because it is an interplay of your genes. In type 2 diabetes mellitus, you can, however, modify your lifestyle, and there is an early detection tools to diagnose this type of diabetes. According to American Diabetes Association, there are other types of diabetes. Gestational diabetes is when a pregnant is seen to have uncontrolled blood sugar levels during pregnancy. Okay? MODY, or maturity onset diabetes of the young, is a type of diabetes similar to type 2 pero more prevalent to younger age. And lastly, your type 3 diabetes mellitus is seen among patients with Alzheimer's disease because they have a problem of insulin resistance as well. Now, here are the classic symptoms and signs of a patient with diabetes. So first, polyphagia means always eating, okay? Laging gutom. Polydipsia, laging uhaw, no? They always drink. Polyuria, dahil lagi silang umiinom, lagi rin silang umiihi. And lastly, no? Weight loss. So hindi madalas nating sinasabi na porket mataba ay diabetic na, no? Minsan may mga payat na merong uncontrolled blood sugar pala. Okay, next NCD is chronic respiratory disease. It is one of the leading cause of death, and among the NCDs, this type of disease have a higher underdiagnosis rate. So hindi madalas na da-diagnose agad. So madalas naman, no, ang nakikita natin sa kanila, pupunta lang ng hospital, malapit na rin silang mamatay. Okay? 90% of the deaths occur in low-income countries. Kasi itong mga chronic respiratory disease, no, ang mga risk factors nila, madalas silang makita sa mga family na may low-income status. So, ano yung mga risk factors na yun? Number one, cigarette smoking. Okay? Number two, environmental exposure, lalong-lalo na at work or indoor air pollution. So, ano ang number one cause of indoor air pollution na yan? Ito yung mga smoke coming from the kitchen. No? Lalong-lalo na kung nagluluto sila gamit yung mga coals. Okay? Next, genes and aging, okay? Infections. Kung palagi kang nagkakaroon ng infection, lalo na that can develop into a untreatable damage to your lungs, number one dyan ay yung tuberculosis. And lastly, your socioeconomic status is also a risk factor. Kapag lagi kang may ubo, no? May sipon, hindi ka naman lagi nagpapa-check up. Papabayaan mo lang hanggang sa mawala, no? Last sa mga i-discuss natin NCDs is cancer. In this disease, abnormal cell grow uncontrollably, okay? And go beyond their usual boundaries to invade other parts of your body. So, there is an interplay of genetic changes that can cause an uncontrollable cell growth. No, etong cell growth na to can also spread throughout your body. Most of the cancer deaths occur in low to middle income countries, brought about the same economic problems as I have mentioned a while ago. And these deaths are estimated to reach 13 million by 2030. And most of the, or about 30% of these cancers are attributable to behavioral or lifestyle risk factors. So based on this graph, okay, the breast cancer is the most prevalent type of cancer on both sexes among all ages, followed by your prostate. Prostate cancer is seen in male patients, okay? And then lung cancer, colorectal cancer, and then cervix uteri. Cervix uteri can only be seen in females. Let's explore more specifically in males. In males, the most prevalent type of cancer is lung cancer, followed by prostate cancer, colorectal cancer, and next, your stomach cancer. So let us now explore the different types of cancer that can be seen in females among all ages. So number one, prevalent type of cancer among females is breast cancer, followed by your colorectal cancer, lung cancer, and cervix uteri cancer. Let's now discuss this specific type of cancer called cervical cancer. Cancer siya, more specifically, dun sa cervix part of the female reproductive system. Most of the cervical cancer is caused by virus called HPV or human papilloma virus. There is also an increased risk for cervical cancer among smokers, no? Patients who take birth control pills for a long time, more specifically, kapag nagtitake sila for more than 5 years. Next, having given birth to 3 or more children. And lastly, having several sexual partners that may increase their predisposition to genital infection with HPV. Dito naman tayo sa lung cancer. Lung cancers are more predominantly seen in men more than women. Okay? There are two types of lung cancer: small cell lung cancer and non-small cell lung cancer. Mas common makita sa hospital ang mga small cell type as compared to your non-small cell type. Pero mas deadly si non-small cell type of lung cancer. So what are the risk factors for lung cancer? Number one, exposure to smoke. Mapa first hand, second hand, or third hand ka pa, no? Then next, occupational exposure sa trabaho, no? Lalong-lalong sa number one, radon, no? Na makikita natin sa mga industries like airplanes, yung mga yan, asbestos, and uranium, okay? And then lastly, your family history. Kapag meron kang na-identify na lung cancer among your grandparents, no, or earlier pa dun sa family tree, pwede kang magkaroon din ng or mataas ang predisposition mo for this particular type of cancer. So let's now discuss the differences between first-hand, second-hand, and third-hand smoking. So kapag sinabi ting first-hand, siya mismo yung gumagamit ng cigarette stick or tobacco. Okay? Ang second-hand or the passive smoker, siya yung nakakalanghap ng smoke directly from a first-hand active smoker. Ano naman ang third-hand smoke? Ang third-hand smoke is the nicotine or other chemicals left on a variety of indoor surfaces. Okay? May naiiwang deposits dun sa mga floor, tables, or chairs, no? And this can actually react to common indoor pollutants, lalo na nung nabanggit ko kanina, no? Yung mga smoke galing sa kitchen. And the mixture between your third-hand smoke and the indoor air pollutants can create a toxic mix as it ages. And that mixture can cling among indoor surfaces. Next type is breast cancer, which occurs more commonly in women. And 1 out of 8 girls will be diagnosed with breast cancer over time. No, the risk factor, the risk or the predisposition with breast cancer increases with age. Okay? So other than age, no, we have other risk factors. Number one, the use of hormone therapy, weight and physical activity. No, nabanggit natin kanina, obesity is also known to cause cancer, specifically breast cancer. Number three is genetics or family history. Lalong-lalo na if positive ka with BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes. So these are can be detected or used as a screening tool bago pa lumitaw yung mga signs and symptoms of breast cancer. And lastly, your age. No, age. Again, no, your risk for breast cancer increases as you age. Okay, lastly is the colorectal cancer, which is third most common type of cancer globally. Risk factors include number one, aging. Kaya madalas, no, 50 years old and above, kailangan na ma-check ang kanilang colon using colonoscopy. Next, unhealthy diet and low exercise. More specifically, low fiber diet can cause colorectal cancer. Next, no, a prolonged history of diabetes and a family history of colorectal cancer. What is the main role of epidemiologists? So, kung ang specialist or consultant sa diagnosis part and will also address the complications part, lalo na pag malala na, ang epidemiologist naman can address the problem before it will happen. So, dun sila sa part that would prevent the occurrence of the risk factors, most especially dun sa modifiable type of risk factors. However, there are a lot of challenges. Number one is that the surveillance of these non-communicable disorders can be difficult. Bakit? Kasi number one, meron tayong lag time before the exposure and the health condition. There is a long interval, no? Long interval or duration before a disease could occur after the exposure. Number two, more than one exposure for a specific health condition. Halimbawa nga, no, meron kang physical inactivity at the same time, palagi kang nagsusmoke. Okay? So, more than one exposure can lead to heart disease. Okay? And lastly, exposure linked to more than one health condition. Example dyan, yung tobacco use natin can cause heart disease, can also cause coronary or chronic respiratory disease. So more than one health condition can be linked to only one risk factor. So kung gagawa tayo ng causal links, no, marami pa talagang cause kung bakit lumalala yung mga or dumadami yung may mga pasyenteng may NCDs. So primary cause kasi ng NCD ay yung mga physiologic risk factors natin. Tumataas ang BP, no, overweight or obesity, raised blood glucose and raised lipids, especially your cholesterol. And these are brought about by your behavioral or lifestyle risk factors. Number one is cigarette smoking, unhealthy diet, physical inactivity, and chronic alcohol use. But before that, no, we can actually point out that these behavioral and risk factors are brought about by the following underlying drivers. Number one, your social determinants of health, globalization, urbanization, and population aging. So these are also seen as the underlying cause or reason behind the predominance of NCDs among low to middle income countries. So as epidemiologists, we have to outline the leading risk factors among these patients. The number one leading risk factor is a metabolic risk factor called your increased blood pressure. Next, tobacco use, followed by high blood glucose, physical inactivity, overweight and obesity, high cholesterol levels. Next is unsafe sex, most especially for your cervical type of cancer, alcohol use, childhood underweight is also pointed as one of the risk factor among NCDs. Diba weird, no? Underweight sila nung bata, but they have a high predisposition to develop heart attacks, diabetes, and other non-communicable disease. Diba? Ang weird nun. And then number 10, lastly, the indoor smoke from solid fuels. Lalo-lalo na yung mga gumagamit ng coals during cooking. So let's discuss the cigarette smoking. So paano natin masasabi na mataas na yung risk niya to develop NCDs? Number one is to calculate the pack years. No? Pack years is calculated by multiplying the average number of packs smoked per day by the number of years of cigarette use. Okay? This is called your pack years. So remember, no, one pack is equal to 20 sticks of cigarettes. So, subukan natin itong problem na to. The patient has smoked 5 packs per day for 10 years. So, using this formula, no, 5 packs, no, 5 times 10 is equal to 50 pack years. So, paano naman kapag hindi naman nakakaubos ng isang pack per day? No, sticks lang, number of sticks lang. So, halimbawa, itong problem natin na to. The patient has smoked 4 sticks per day for 5 years. So, paano natin siya i-compute? So, 4 divided by 20, kasi 20 cigarette sticks per 1 pack, multiply by 5. Okay? So, dapat 4 divided by 20 times 5 is equal to 1 pack. Actually, tobacco can kill up to half of its users. Okay? Nearly 6 million people each year can be killed from the complications of prolonged cigarette smoking. And nearly 80% of cigarette smokers come from low to middle income countries. So this is ironic, di ba? Wala nang ang pera, but still, mahilig pa rin sa cigarette. Kasi one of our cultural practices, no, ay yung paninigarilyo. Lalo na in some third world countries. Next na pag-uusapan natin ay diet. Okay? There has been an observed global changes in the diet or the food intake among people. There is already an increased daily consumption of the following. First, the daily calories, tumaas daw, no? The daily intake of fats and meats, and the energy-dense food or the nutrient-poor food, such as, number one, starches, refined sugars na makikita natin sa mga candies, and trans fats na madalas din makita sa mga preservative or preserved food. So this is a list of complications or health effects of poor diet. Number one is coronary heart disease or heart attack, okay? Stroke, cancer, type 2 diabetes, hypertension, diseases of the liver and gallbladder. Bakit kaya? No, lalong-lalo na yung kapag high cholesterol diet ka, no, naiipon yung cholesterol, the liver would tend to increase all its bile levels to emulsify the fats. Therefore, magkakaroon ng over activity of the liver. And then yung bile na yon pupunta sa gallbladder. Kapag na-stuck sila dyan, magiging gallstone. And lastly, the obesity. So aside from poor diet, nakitaan din ng global changes in physical activity seen on almost one-third of world's population. The reason behind this is as follows. Number one, aging population. So, mas maraming matanda in one country, lesser yung physical activity nila. Number two, transportation. Mas madali yung mode of transportation. So, meron tayong downside dyan. Less yung physical exertion ng mga tao. And lastly, the advancement of communication technology. If there is downside to transportation, same din dito sa third reason na to. Okay? So there are a lot of non-communicable diseases implicated to physical inactivity. Number one is coronary heart disease, type 2 diabetes, breast cancer, which is implicated again to overweight, no, due to physical inactivity, colon cancer, okay, and premature mortality. Ano ibig sabihin ng premature mortality na to? Maagang namamatay age lower than the life expectancy in a country. Okay. Any physical activity is better than none at all. It is never too late to get more active to improve your health. It is recommended that doing light to vigorous exercise, for example, 30 minutes per day for 5 days per week, can help lower your weight, cholesterol levels, and blood pressure. Next modifiable risk factor is alcohol use. 11.5% of all alcohol consumers are episodic heavy users. Ano ibig sabihin ng episodic? So, meron siyang certain episodes lang ng alcohol use. Halimbawa, dyan, no, nagsiset sila ng dates for binge drinking. Halimbawa, every after sweldo or every after major examination, umiinom. So, hindi siya technically occasional use. No? These are termed as episodic frequency. So, almost 2.5 million alcohol drinkers die each year. Pero, no, makikita natin sa mga alcohol consumers na yan, they can drink at low risk levels lang. So, ano ba yung tinatawag nating low risk, moderate drinking, and binge drinking? So, kailangan natin maging conscious on the amount of alcohol. So, madalas na makikita niyo yung percentage of alcohol per drink. So, makikita nyo if ever 5% ang alcohol content nung iniinom nyo, hanggang 12 ounces lang yung pwede nating sabihin standard drink yon or moderate drinking pa rin tayo. Okay, more than that, no, pwede na natin sabihin na you are a binge drinker na. So, how many alcoholic drinks per day is recommended? According to CDC, one drink per day for women, okay? Two drinks or less for men, or no, mas recommended to, wala nang drinks at all. Next risk factor is a metabolic one, no? High blood pressure. So your blood pressure changes throughout the day based on your activities. Having a blood pressure consistently above normal may result to a diagnosis of hypertension. So, what is a normal blood pressure? According to the 2017 guidelines published by American Heart Association, these are your blood pressure categories. So, for us to have a normal blood pressure, the systolic BP should be lower than 120 and the diastolic BP should be lower than 180. You can be classified as having elevated blood pressure if your BP falls between 120 to 129 over the diastolic of lower than 80. Hypertension stage 1 is 130 to 139 or 80 to 89 as diastolic BP. Hypertension stage 2 is more than or equal to 140 over more than or equal to 90. And lastly, hypertensive crisis results from a systolic BP of higher than 180 and diastolic BP of higher than 120. So, from this table, you can now manage your patient. So, halimbawa sa clinic, no, madalas natin naririnig yung 120 over 80 na blood pressure. Hindi na yon normal. You can now categorized it as elevated na, according to the 2017 AHA guidelines. Okay. Prior to labeling a person with hypertension, it is important to use an average based on more than or equal to 2 readings obtained on more than or equal to 2 occasions to estimate the level of your blood pressure. Anong ibig sabihin nito? So, kailangan, no, para makuha mo talaga yung tamang diagnosis, kailangan yung taas ng BP ng pasyente mo ay nakita natin in more than or equal to 2 separate readings. Dalawang kuha ng BP on more than 2 different occasions. So, hindi pwedeng all in the same day. Okay? Kailangan different day natin sila nakuha. So, there is an association between your high blood pressure and your sodium intake. No? The recommended daily allowance For sodium is 1,500 to 2,300 milligrams per day. Most of the sodium we consume is in the form of salt. The vast majority of sodium we consume is in processed and restaurant foods. So your body needs a small amount of sodium to work properly, but too much sodium is bad for your health. So why is that? So sodium draws in more water into the body, increasing the blood volume, which gives a bad effect. Because high blood pressure or high blood volume means high pressure pushing the arteries, hence causing hypertension. So for us to modify the intake of sodium, the CDC recommended the DASH diet. So anong ibig sabihin ng DASH diet? DASH stands for Dietary Approaches to Stop Hypertension. It is one of the well-studied lifestyle and it requires no special food. It is actually flexible and can be adopted for the entire family. So, no need na to i-memorize. Okay? Ipapakita ko lang sa inyo na hindi boring ang pagkain ng isang taong may hypertension. The DASH diet recommends the following intake. So, mostly, no, grains yan. Okay? And then, vegetables, fruits. Pwede rin silang mag-intake ng fat-free or low-fat dairy products. Nuts, seeds, and legumes. Pwede pa rin naman ang mga meat, pero lalong-lalo na lean meat, no, type of food, poultry or fish. Pwede rin sila sa sweets, no, less than 5 servings per week. Pwede sila sa mga ganong candy or ice cream. And lastly, so pwede pa rin sila sa fatty food. Yun nga lang, no, 2 to 3 servings per day, which is hindi pa rin boring. Okay? Masarap pa rin naman yung diet ng mga hypertensive patients. So aside from high sodium intake, no, another factor is the high cholesterol levels. The mechanism of bad effects of high cholesterol is they tend to hide in between the layers of your blood vessels, causing damage and inflammation. Therefore, no, again, no, the elasticity of these blood vessels are severely affected. Next risk factor is high blood sugar. Patients with high blood sugar are mostly asymptomatic, but you can detect it through laboratory. So, using your fasting blood sugar, these are the expected normal range. So, what is the expected normal range for blood sugar? So, it should be less than 100 milligrams per deciliter. Okay? You are already at risk or tinatawag natin pre-diabetic if you have a fasting blood sugar of 101 to 126 milligrams per deciliter. And lastly, to diagnose diabetes, your FBS should be greater than 126 milligrams per deciliter. Another important test is HbA1c, and this does not require fasting. Mas madali for the patient. More convenient than for the doctors because this test can monitor the glucose status in the past 3 months. The normal value for HbA1c is less than 5.7%. For pre-diabetes, 5.7 to 6%, while diabetic patients have more than 6% HbA1c. Okay, last topic na tayo, overweight and obesity. So, for us to determine kung overweight ka, or normal ka, or underweight ka, so kailangan natin i-compute yung BMI. BMI stands for Body Mass Index. It takes into consideration your height and your weight. Okay? So, these are the expected values for each nutritional status. So, if ever underweight ka, no? Before that, there are two types of normal ranges of BMI. So, magkaiba ang non-Asian and Asian BMI. So, papansin nyo, mas mataas yung cut-off ng mga nasa non-Asian BMI as compared to your Asian classification. Unahin natin yung underweight, no? Pareha sila, less than 18.5. Sa normal, ang non-Asian, 18.5 to 24.9. Sa Asian classification, 18.5 to 22.9. Overweight naman, non-Asians, no? 25 to 29.9. Mas mababa sa mga Asian classification, 23 to 24.9. Meron din tayong tinatawag na pre-obese na makikita lang sa Asian classification. Dito papasok si 25 to 29.9 BMI. Pagdating sa stage ng obesity, we have three different classes. Sa class 1, parehas, no, na 30 to 40. Then class 2, 40.1 to 50. And then class 3 is more than 50. So how to compute your BMI? So this is the formula for BMI depending on what is the given unit. Okay? Kapag metric ang formula, no? Kilograms over meter squared. Okay. Kapag imperial units ang given, no? 703 multiply by pounds over inches squared. So gawin natin itong problem na to. A Thai patient weighs 75 kilograms with a height of 5'9". So gusto ko mahirapan. Gusto ko itong formula na to. Gawin natin to. So, ang unang step natin dyan is to convert this height into inches. So, 5 feet, meron tayong 12 inches per foot. Okay? So, 5 times 12 plus 9, no, is equal to 69 inches. Ito namang 75 kilograms, i-convert natin into pounds. Per kilogram, there is 2.2 pounds. So, 75 multiplied by 2.2 is equal to 165 pounds. Okay, substitute na natin yung values using your imperial BMI formula. 703 multiplied by 165 pounds over, or divided by 69 squared. So, ito muna yung i-solve natin and then multiply natin by 703 is equal to 24.36. Okay? Subukan nyo sa inyong calculator if tama or parehas tayo ng answer. So, hindi lang dyan matatapos yung ating computation. Kailangan natin i-interpret yung value natin. If ang pasyente natin is a thigh, no? So, Asian yan. So, dun tayo sa Asian classification. Ang value niya is 24.36. So, magpo-fall siya under overweight classification. So, that is my last slide. Next week, quiz tayo and try to answer the posted self-test over the weekend. Happy studying and see you next semester!